Campus of Syracuse University in Syracuse, New York. And inside, you may be looking at history. It could be the largest on-campus crowd ever in college basketball. And they are revving up for Georgetown and Syracuse. The Total Sports Network presents College Basketball 85. Tonight, the second-ranked Georgetown Hoyas take on the 10th-ranked Syracuse Orangemen. February 12, 1980, a rivalry is born. The last game played at Manly Fieldhouse. Ed Spriggs for Georgetown and Roosevelt Bowie called for goaltending. Georgetown ties Syracuse 50-50. And when Sleepy Floyd hits two foul shots, Georgetown wins by two. Syracuse's 57-game Manly Fieldhouse win streak ends, as does Manly. A year later, Georgetown comes visiting again, only this time at the newly built Carrier Dome. A small crowd by tonight's standards, just 17,000. Again, it's tied up late. Eric Smith ties the game at 64 after the Hoyas had trailed by 17 at halftime. And on a controversial play, Marty Head scores with 5 seconds left. And this time, Syracuse wins by two. Their last meeting, March 10th, 1984, the Big East Championship game at Madison Square Garden. And with 98 seconds left, Pearl Washington gives underdog Syracuse a two-point lead. But Michael Jackson hits the jumper, and it forces overtime. Patrick Ewing then takes charge and leads Georgetown to the Big East title, 82-71. But there is controversy and bad feelings, and tonight they meet again as the rivalry continues. See that television screen? Well, the crowd is so huge inside the Carrier Dome, perhaps over 32,000, that some people who paid to get in will watch on that big screen TV far from where the play is taking place at the other side of the dome. The top 10 rankings just released. St. John's now number one, Georgetown number two, Syracuse number 10 in the ESPN poll out today. Syracuse even higher in the national poll. Well, hi again, everyone. Welcome to Syracuse, New York. Nice to have you with us. Len Berman with Bill Raftery. And with Georgetown suffering its first defeat Saturday, coming into this atmosphere, I guess they're looking to start another winning streak.
Well, of course, last time they lost, they won 29 games in a row. They're a tough team mentally. They reach back. They overcome adversity. They're very tough-minded. A little bit like the Oakland Raiders, the response they create in a building like this.
Well, with St. John's and Georgetown getting so much publicity in this conference, Syracuse has just sneaked up to the top 10.
Well, they forget there are some quality players here. Syracuse is not deep. Up front, they're not overly tall, nor do they have that depth up front. But they press, they can mix it up, they throw different defenses at you, they can run the ball, and of course they always have the Pearl, who has some magic in his ability.
Forget for a moment Pearl Washington and Patrick Ewing. Who are some of the other guys who could play a key role tonight?
Well, Michael Brown, and the Pearl's important because he's got to get him into the ball game. He played poorly against St. John's, but he's a very capable scorer, but he has to get more shots. He's only taken approximately 8 a game.
All right, so we have the top scoring team in the Big East and the number one defense in the Big East. Back at the Carrier Dome, we're about to turn on the switch so we can address the crowd as well. So here go the starting lineups for tonight's game. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Here are the starting lineups for tonight's game. First for the Georgetown Hoyas. At forward, a 6'7 senior from Washington, D.C., number 24, Bill Martin. At forward, a 6'5 junior from Baltimore, Maryland, number 40, David Wingate. At center, a 7-foot senior from Cambridge, Massachusetts, the United States Olympic gold medalist, number 33, Patrick Ewing. At guard, a 6'7 sophomore from Baltimore, Maryland, number 34, Reggie Williams. At guard, a 6'2 junior from Reston, Virginia, number 30, Michael Jackson. The coach of the Hoyas, John Thompson. And now for the Syracuse Orangemen, at forward, a 6'7 junior from Jersey City, New Jersey, number 12, Raphael Addison. At forward, a 6'8 senior from Lakeview, New York, number 53, Andre Hawkins. At center, a 6'10 freshman from Athens, Greece, number 4, Ronnie Cycli. At guard, a 6'4 freshman from Baltimore, Maryland, number 35, Michael Brown. At guard, a 6'2 sophomore from Brooklyn, New York, number 31, Dwayne Washington. And the coach of the Orangemen, Jim Boeheim. That was incredible. I don't know if the fans heard that. I sort of heard myself. We'll be back with the opening tip-off, Georgetown and Syracuse, in just a minute. I wonder if Ronnie Cycli, when he was born in Lebanon and grew up in Athens, Greece, thought about a young man named Patrick Ewing.
Never heard of him. And don't forget, when Patrick Ewing was a freshman, he got 12.7 points and 7.5 rebounds, but he did pretty well at the end of that year.
Shaking hands. Remember the hard feelings at Madison Square Garden last year between Andre Hawkins and the now-departed Michael Graham and the Phantom Ejection, which perhaps cost Syracuse the Big East Championship. John Thompson remembers, I'm sure. Jim Boeheim certainly remembers, and so does Andre Hawkins in the middle of it. Hank Nichols standing between them. Everyone on their feet. I can't believe the atmosphere. Here we go from Syracuse, everybody.
You know, what you hope early is that the players don't foul in their anxiety.
I hope the announcers and the technical crowd, the crew, don't foul either. All right, here's Addison. Gets it over to the Pearl. He's watched by Jackson. The Pearl hits it.
They can sit down early.
An orange comes on the floor. It's still on the floor, and now they stop play to remove an orange, which people threw in tribute to the Syracuse Orange.
Well, they had trouble in Florida with the cold spell. Apparently, up in this country, the oranges grow without any problem.
All right, here we work to Wingate. Looks for Ewing. Pearl steals. Here comes the break. And the Pearl lost it. You know, he's been in and out the last couple of weeks, but it seems that he's always up for the big games.
He likes the lights, the crowds, the excitement.
He had that game at the Garden the other night against St. John's, losing in overtime. And a good one Saturday against Pittsburgh, scoring 30.
He'll try and do a lot of things, too. That was not a good play by a player of his ability. 2-3 set by Syracuse.
Right, they're letting Ewing roam low. Hawkins turn around to look for him. Here's Williams. Reggie killed them a year ago in this game here. Saves it.
It's going to be a foul.
And a foul is called on Reggie Williams after he lost it.
Now, Reggie Williams is a key, and Michael Jackson has to get him into the basketball game. He's an excellent shooter. He didn't play well Saturday.
He scored just 2 points against St. John's, which is slightly unbelievable. They break the press. Addison. He's got it. They are roaring in Syracuse. It's 4-0 Orange. Wingate quiets them down, perhaps.
Georgetown's played all over the world in all sets of circumstances. They react very well.
Addison open. Brown short. Cycli a third chance. Ronnie Cycli hits it. It's 6-2 Syracuse.
It's obvious Jimmy Boeheim's going to try in front and play somebody behind Patrick Ewing when he can. Of course, Andre Hawkins in the back one side, a little more physical than Raphael Addison.
Patrick Cycli blocked him. Michael Jackson. Jackson killed Syracuse on this floor 2 years ago. Didn't play in last year's game. I get St. John's, he had 12, but he leads the Big East in assists.
I get a kick out of Michael Jackson. He's expressionless, very calm looking. always under control.
The Pearls on fire, and they foul. Wingate raised his hand.
Are they going to give it to Martin? I thought maybe Patrick Ewing got involved in it. They all tried to bail out with that one.
They did give it to Ewing. Wingate tried to say it was me, not Patrick.
Heads up.
Trying to protect them.
You learn that very early in your basketball career. Always protect the better performer.
Georgetown played virtually the entire team in the first half against St. John's. Curious to see how deep they go tonight. Syracuse, on the other hand, is just a seven-player team. They don't go deep.
You know, it's easy to say that about Georgetown, but John's done it throughout his coaching career. He has tremendous confidence in his bench. He feels they should be ready, and they have to contribute. Who can argue after last year?
You know, the only failing in this Big East Conference has to be free throw shooting. The Pearl average is just 52%. The Hoyas perhaps lost Saturday because of their foul shooting. Missed 11 against St. John's. All right, 6-4 Syracuse. Wingate nearly traveled. Back out to Jackson. He played a little over 2 minutes at the Carrier Dome. Williams got Addison to commit. They're going to call the two-shot foul against Raphael Addison.
Reggie Williams and all great jump shooters. Get people to react. Jump out on them. Pump that fake up. Now the lean in, just as Raphael had committed, wisely going up and getting a deuce. And he's got to become active offensively. Reggie Williams.
Let's see what Georgetown does tonight from the foul line. John Thompson says they've struggled for 2 years at the foul line. They start out that way again. Just 48% does Reggie Williams shoot from the foul line. And that's amazing for such a fine shooter.
I really believe players nowadays like to be touching somebody when they shoot the basketball.
The fans behind us finally sat down for the first time this evening. Starting to quiet down a bit, thankfully. It's Syracuse 6, Georgetown 5. We've played 2.5 minutes. Man-to-man go the Hoyas. Addison blocked away. Hoyas with their first fast break. Over to Ewing. Fouled as he went for the dunk.
And Patrick Ewing just discharged the Pearl, put Washington into the stanchion. Actually, his teeth may have hit Patrick. A good look here. Good hands by Patrick Ewing. He's got to catch it quickly, go up. And no question about the strength, running the floor well. And the Pearl, poor judgment. If he wants the last, stay out of the way of Patrick Ewing.
The first thing Pearl did was reach for his nose to see if there was any blood.
Rearranged.
Ewing shoots better from the field than the foul line. Again, he likes to have three guys all over. Ewing's just a 62% foul shooter, but hit the first one, although he hit iron along the way.
Nice looking rotation, good form.
So the Hoyas with their first lead at 7-6.
Bad dribble. Very
Brown
fortunate
gets it
there.
Back. And a travel is called.
Again, it's hard to play as a freshman, much less at the intensity level of the Big East. And Michael Brown has to relax. Saw the Pearl talking to him. Just calm down.
Syracuse has two freshmen, a sophomore, and the Pearl. And Ewing misses. Look at the scramble. Here comes the Pearl, everybody. Showtime.
Offense.
Offensive foul called, and Washington can't believe it. His second personal foul.
I'll agree with the call because Patrick Ewing waited in the back. He waited for the Pearl to come to him. You'll see the lean in. A very fine, knowledgeable offensive move, but staying on the ground. Pearl detected for the foul.
Reggie Williams. Wingate the offensive rebound.
You're saying hit the stanchion underneath.
Yep.
Ronnie, cyclically very active, got a piece of Patrick Ewing.
Bill Martin over Addison. Ewing fouled by cyclically.
And Jimmy Boeheim's liable to get a T. He went wild. He did it within the coach's box. Very tough to push a man of Patrick Ewing. Size and bulk out of the way there, uncontested. Cycli, it looked like all ball.
Wow. Well, Cycli picks up his first, the fourth already against Syracuse, and we've only played 3 minutes and 26 seconds.
You know, Len, it's taking a while for them to warm up, isn't it? They're not very competitive.
That should not be fair. Another
free throw.
Yes.
That should be, and John Thompson's coming out. That should be another shot.
And Orange hit the back of the backboard, and they are going to give him another shot. And Orange hit the back of the backboard and broke in two.
Well, they want a T now because he's out of the box, but John's looking for a correctable error. John's bringing his team away. He's very upset, trying to calm the crowd down.
He pulled his team off the floor, and Orange hit the backboard just as Ewing took the shot.
He wants an announcement made, I believe. He said, I'm going to pull them. If you don't have the crowd, stop.
Well, that's dangerous. I'm glad it hit the backboard.
Absolutely.
Because it came from the end zone, and that could have been dangerous.
Well, no call for it. There's no fun in it. Very poor judgment on the part of some irate fan. Jay Krauthammel's up on the baseline, the AD. Trying to calm everybody down, and of course Patrick Ewing back, and if they're here to enjoy the game, they should stop the nonsense. And I agree with John.
I think that's a good call to give him is it in the rule book?
Disconcerting. Bill? Oh, it's like anybody, a fan, you can call a T on the crowd, you can do anything you want on that crowd, but it would be like a player hollering or throwing something.
All right, they're announcing the public address system that a repeat of that performance would result in a two-shot technical foul, and they're imploring to the home crowd to tell them that that would hurt the team if such a technical were called. But the Orange definitely hit before Patrick was about to release the ball.
There's no call for it on any level of basketball, and deservedly so. Patrick Ewing is going to get two.
This is unbelievable, and we've only played 3 minutes and 26 seconds. All right, now they're pulling the team off the floor to clean the backboard, we are informed. Because the Orange splattered on the backside of
the
backboard.
Jimmy Boeheim's making an announcement now. They can forfeit the game also.
All right, Jim Boeheim said any object thrown that he will personally ask for a technical foul called against his team, and he pointed to a section of the crowd which engages in off-color language, and he pointed to that section of the crowd and said, if I hear that chant, I am going to ask for a technical foul. So Jim Boeheim doing the sportsmanlike thing, talking to John Thompson, as you see.
And well, they've been through some battles, and it's a great move by Jimmy Boeheim. Well, he, in a sense, is responsible for his team. The backboard being clean now. Of course, some of those people he was pointing to used to be in your fraternity, I think.
And I can't help but tip my cap to Jim Boeheim for the announcement, and also to Patrick Ewing for what he has put up with over 4 years. The signs that people hold up talking about his academic performance. It's unbelievable what the man has been through 4 years of, and he's a college student.
Well, the old story, it's made him a better person. Obviously, he's grown as a player, and you have to attribute that to the soundness of the Georgetown program. I mean,
he can't argue with his success. He has never once spoken out against any of it and what he has been through.
I think he sat there, analyzed, and I'm sure his friends are solid ones, and he realizes that there's a lot of people out there that are not on his side. And there's
Thompson,
one that is.
Certainly identify the old line, was it Will Chamberlain claiming that nobody loves a big man? And it's certainly tough when you're the All-American gold medalist star of your team and win 29 games in a row and be subjected to what he's subjected to.
Well, he's going to win at any level he performs because he contributes so much.
That only tells you part of the story. As we chronicled at the beginning of the broadcast, one game we didn't have time to tell you about was the game 2 years ago. We were talking to Leo Routens, who's here at Street Clothes, who played in that game. Has had some stints in the NBA. We're talking about that night when Georgetown took an 18-point lead 2 years ago. Syracuse came back and took the lead by one, and Michael Jackson hit about as pretty a 23-foot jumper from the top of the circle to the right that you'll ever see as a freshman. He did it 2 years ago, and Georgetown won that game. It's really perhaps the premier rivalry in the Big East, despite the St. John's Georgetown and the St. John's Villanova and the BC. This rivalry right here has been the cornerstone of our Monday night Big East series and perhaps the top rivalry in the conference.
It may have emanated from the Manly Fieldhouse game. Yep. That riled the Syracuse contingent.
Meanwhile, back at the ranch, the backboard has been cleaned, the crowd has been warned, and Patrick Ewing shooting two shots once again. This one he hits where he had missed the other one when the orange hit.
Now, we're not supposed to root, but I was delighted he made that for all the nonsense.
It's now 8-6 Georgetown. And he hits two. Is he something?
Well, that'll place the citrus grove in its proper position, huh?
Right. In a deep freeze, perhaps. Syracuse trying to break across. They got 1 second. They don't do it. The shot clock is at 33.
That's finally got it. I believe the whistle was blown, but with the noise, you can't hear anybody. And don't forget, against St. John's against Georgetown, they did a good job getting the ball to Weddington in the middle to beat the press, because Patrick Ewing doesn't come up real tough. He's back there to protect. So you might look for that run cycling.
It's a 45-second shot clock, so when it gets under 35, you have to be across half court. Jackson on the miss. Here goes the Pearl. Once again, he's got Brown on this side and Addison. Oh!
Well, that's the second time Rafael Addison's run the floor very well.
All right, it's 9-8 Georgetown. The next dead ball will be a television timeout. We've played 4 minutes. There's the dead ball. And if they can hear the buzzer, they'll call a television timeout. So, Patrick Ewing, 4 free throws. Georgetown leading Syracuse by 1.
With 4 minutes 31 seconds remaining in the first half, and Georgetown leading Syracuse 30-21.
Georgetown has stretched open a 9-point advantage, 30-21.
This is the third tip or follow-up where Patrick Ewing goes in untouched. You've got to put a hip on the franchise.
This isn't hockey.
Even when you check him out, he still can tip the ball or go over you, but you've got to touch him.
And wow. He may set a rebounding record here. That's a lot of rebounds for a first half. We still have 4:31 to play. 12 rebounds already.
Hart, great competitor.
Oh, look at this. Syracuse shooting 20% from the foul line. And remember, the one miss is really the front end of a 1-1. It happened twice in a row. So going 0-2 is going 0-4, really.
Mm-hmm. Evening of contrast.
Syracuse needs something. Hawkins back in the lineup. Andre Hawkins without a point. His point production down from a year ago and shut out tonight. And fighting with Mateen. Elbows flying. And it goes against Mateen after Hawkins retaliated.
Well, earlier, Reggie Williams was on Andre Hawkins. He's a very tough post-up player. John Thompson looking for the push-off. Hawkins is not afraid to flail the arms, and can't blame John for asking. Take a look now. 51.
Look at the top left hand.
Ooh. Is there a dental school here?
Hawkins. And Syracuse misses another front end, but Addison gets it back for him. Syracuse 1-for-6, and again, that's more like 1-for-9.
Well, you can see that throw there.
Cycling travel. Foul is called. He went up and down.
On Ewing,
all
too.
Right, that's the one that Ewing should have been called for before.
But
okay?
As a coach, you don't think that way. You think you deserve them from years ago. And, of course, John is probably still hot. He was right on Andre Hawkins' push-off on Grady Mateen. But Michael Brown really throwing the ball. He almost flicked the ball on the release. The long rebound. And Cycling, of course, new to the game, maybe just learning the rules. You can't go up and down. But Ronnie saw Ewing, said, what am I doing up here?
And Syracuse hits a free throw and ends the drought. Boeheim candidly says about Cycling, growing up in a foreign country, he is 4 years behind American players.
Well, Billy Weddington's a great example. I just think all the foreign play has made him such an improved basketball player. And the same's going to happen here with Ron Cycling.
People forget Winnington's a Canadian native. All right, Syracuse gets a point back. 4 minutes to go, 30-22. And because Boeheim took that timeout before, you won't see another television timeout taken.
And the man. Timeout for the man-to-man.
Ewing has two personals on him. Both teams in the bonus.
They're going to be a charge. David Wingate. Andre Hawkins stepping in. What's interesting to me, though, is Patrick Ewing is posting up. He's wide open. And Georgetown is so good, they can play without him. Hawkins giving up his body. Terrific reaction. The step in. This is a little drill. The Pearl didn't slide down, though. He should have been down there in front of Grady Mateen. Hawkins, good step in. No rotation from the Pearl. A little bit tired, I think.
All right. So it's not called the player control foul. Since he released the ball, there are foul shots. You're wondering why there are free throws on an offensive foul. If you've already released the ball, you get the shots. If not, it's called player control and no free throws. Is that right?
And it, yes, and you're doing a good job. Even with your busy schedule, reading the rules.
All right. So Hawkins hits a foul shot. Syracuse within seven. Hawkins, what he's scoring. Last year he was over 10 points a game. This year he's under seven. All right, 30-24. 3:40 remaining first half.
Now, Cycli should be tested with you and I. See, this is twice now, going on the road.
Cycli, another block. How many blocks is that for Cycli? Three. Pearl and Addison having trouble playing catch on the far side.
Michael Brown's not looking for that shot now.
Addison over Wingate, and the foul is called on Wingate, which is his second. Nobody has more than two personals, but a host of players have two.
John Thompson doesn't want to give the ball up. Hank Nichols is going over to get it. Rafael has a nice ball fake. Good, and underneath. And that, John and Hank Nichols, as we see Wingate prone. John was holding on to the ball. Hank Nichols and he with a pleasant exchange.
So now Addison will try his luck at the line. This reminds me of a carnival. Each player steps up, step up, young man, see what you can do at the line. And now Addison will have his try tonight. Here's Addison hits. Here's a fellow who shot 84% from the line last year. Mysteriously, he's down to 58. It's unbelievable.
And a fine jump shooter, too.
All right, 100% on that effort. And now Syracuse has run off the last 5 points. So what was a 9-point deficit is cut to four. 3:12 remaining. The crowd is up yelling for defense.
Patrick Ewing is wide open three times, has not touched the ball. Jackson finally.
And a foul. A Cycli hit him and Ewing scored it.
Well, that's what I love about Patrick Ewing's attitude. He doesn't shrug his shoulders. He hasn't touched the basketball. There he is. A lot of players would quit, put their head down. Now he busts the pump. Good screen away.
Oh, that's pretty
close. Post up. Finish it off. Ronnie up in the air, Cycli.
How about a little credit for Perry McDonald for that screen?
Good screen away, but also Michael Jackson, the only pure point guard out there, drilling it home.
Ewing completes the three-point play. The only question here, will he have more points or rebounds in the first half? He now has 13 points. Inside of 3 minutes, the Hoyas lead by seven. Addison run into by Martin, and that's Bill's second. Two on Martin, two on Jackson, two on Ewing, two on Williams, two on Wingate, and for Syracuse, two on Cycli, Addison, and Washington.
That's one of those nickel-dime calls. Now, Billy Martin didn't mean it, didn't have any effect on the play. That's one of those rules I would love, where the ref puts his hand up.
Uh-huh.
If there's a turnover or something, then you blow the whistle.
Oh, like hockey?
Very similar. Play on. I said that about 5 years ago.
And they listen to you as well. But
Ed Stites doesn't agree with me.
Now, let me hear that. If there's incidentally a hold, the referee would hold up his hand.
Right, and then if there's a turnover or you lose the ball for some reason or a walk, you have to call it.
Okay.
Otherwise, let it go, play on.
Oh. Syracuse has hit their last seven foul shots after missing several.
I'm curious to see if they go to the big man. Get the franchise in the ball game.
And Cycli out of it. Because the next, you know, any player here virtually will have three fouls in a minute.
Great pump fake.
Oh!
Hawkins tipped it away from his own man. Syracuse gets it back. These guys playing in foul trouble here, folks, with all this action. Inside of 2.5 minutes remaining, Syracuse trying to cut it to three. Michael Brown blocked by Perry McDonald. The talent on this floor is unbelievable.
Glad to see Michael Brown looking, and two guys banging now. Billy Martin and Michael Brown just whacked one another. But from Syracuse and Michael Brown, if he had control of that opening, but look at the reaction. Billy Martin came,
that play?
And then the recovery by McDonald. That's what makes them so tough. They don't give you an easy shot.
And here goes McDonald against Monroe. One-on-one, two little guys get a chance. And it doesn't go. And it was nice to see two small guys one-on-one on the playground.
McDonald had a free man there and didn't get rid of the basketball in time.
When I say small guys, it's all relative. I mean, they're listed over 6 feet, hopefully. When you have Ewings and Cyclades in there, it's very different. Inside of 2 minutes now. Syracuse wants to close it to within three. Good pass, Addison, and Cycle threw up an air ball of unbelievable proportions.
That's Patrick Ewing's block, though.
Hawkins! His first field goal. Syracuse within three, 90 seconds to go in the first half.
Grant Cycle is letting Patrick Ewing get any position he wants on the floor. Just stepping in. Foul on Cycle.
There it is, the third foul, Bill, just what we were talking about.
He's too late with his foot position. He's not bodying, he's not creating the proper angle to defend a player of this proportion. There he is waiting. He's on a level with him. You have to be on top of Pat. He's got to have that right leg closed. He's too late. You've got to be there early, closed, in a denied position, ready to step in front if necessary.
Cycle has scored 3 points, grabbed 4 rebounds, blocked 3 shots, and committed 3 personal fouls. 1-1 here for Ewing. 14 points. What a half he's having. Hasn't missed a foul shot. 6 for 6 from the line.
Well, what's amazing about Georgetown is they can play most of their games with their great players and not use Patrick offensively. I mean, he can play some offense when he does get the ball. Of course, the man-to-man has opened everything for him.
Jackson replaced by Brodnax. Ewing looking for his 15th point. First missed foul shot. So, Georgetown's lead is 4. You see a minute 15 remaining now. First half. Syracuse trailed 9 and they came back. Hitting the foul shots helped them too.
The man-to-man helped a little because they had a few charges called and they forgot about Patrick Ewing. Now they're going to him.
Inside of a minute remaining. Addison looking for a shot. Takes it. Hits it! Ref! 34-32 Georgetown. 40 seconds remaining, first half. Ewing against Hawkins. Brodnax, short. Brodnax saves it. It was out of bounds. Syracuse ball, 31 seconds. They can play for one shot and a tie.
Jimmy Boeheim agreeing with you.
Georgetown's missed 5 in a row.
One thing you must remember, you can't shoot too early. Georgetown plays on a smaller court than most teams in the country. Their speed and quickness make it an easy run up and down.
Let's just watch it and see if they tie it at halftime. It would be a fitting conclusion to the first half. 15. 10.
John Sain in the 2-3.
5. Monroe.
Shot it at the right time. A steal. No goal.
They're going wild in Syracuse. 34-34. And Thompson's just staying. Everybody else is left. John Thompson, hands in pockets, now heads to the locker room. We have a tie basketball game after 20 minutes, Bill.
That look spoke volumes.
Maybe a record crowd. They saw a terrific first half. We're tied.
Hey, Dome in Syracuse, New York. We're tied at halftime. Let's breeze through some halftime statistics to let you know how it got to be 34-34. And let's start off with the field goal percentage. Georgetown off 39%. They're taking a couple more shots than Syracuse has. Free throws. Syracuse heated up after that dry spell. Georgetown doing a whole lot better than they have all season. They're the worst free throw shooting team in the Big East Conference. Rebounds. 14 of the 21 belong to Patrick, or 13 belong to Patrick. 14 and the 14 turnovers there for Syracuse.
And Syracuse at 45%. You know, Georgetown does a great job defensively. Makes you take the tough shot, 39% and change normally.
So the foul situation on the right, a little bit more important than even the points. Ewing, Jackson, Williams, Wingate, four starters, two fouls apiece. And the Syracuse statistic that we'll really have to keep our eye on is Ronnie Cicely having to deal with Ewing, who's having a terrific game. Cicely at the bottom with 3 points and three fouls, but Raphael Addison leading them with 12 points, but he has two fouls as well, as does Washington.
You know, Hawkins with only one is a good sign for Syracuse, because at worst, he's used to bodying up Patrick Ewing. He's late and can force him out another step, so you're in good shape that way.
Well, those are the points where they borrowed that, the foul line.
They borrowed that word from somebody.
I don't know who.
Some announcer. I don't know. Used to wear low-cut sneakers and tell everybody he was better than his brother.
All right, they're on their feet. It wasn't McGuire, was it?
Well, I think that was it. Big out.
Syracuse bench and the fans will not sit down until they score a field goal at the beginning of each half. Syracuse starts off looking for the lead. They trailed by 9 in the first half and clawed their way back.
Look who's out of the top of the 2-3. Patrick Ewing. And watch the mobility. Slides into a 3-2 out of this.
Syracuse is showing patience. The shot clock, the 45-second clock, is now down to 10.
How would you like to have to shoot over Patrick when you're 6 feet, 5'11"?
I wouldn't. Hawkins is fouled by Martin. So most of the times when you see a foul call here on out, it's going to be somebody's third. That's Bill Martin's third.
Well, unfortunately for Georgetown, they had Syracuse using the entire shot clock and then the giveaway. Very harmful. They had done a sound job defensively.
So Andre goes to the line. First half, he was 2 of 3. And Syracuse leads. We had a great little statistic worked up, Bill. Whenever Syracuse trails at halftime, they win the game. That's happened every time this year, but of course, that little statistic wiped out. We were tied at halftime.
And also, Jimmy Boeheim, a compliment or a bouquet thrown his way. The crowd, after that sort of unattractive incident early, Tony Orange at the backboard, totally calmed down, just enjoying the ball game and into it in a nice way.
You weren't with us early. We had a delay. Jackson hits, which he did not do in the first half. He hits the outside shot. We're tied again at 36. Early in the game, with Ewing at the foul line, Orange splattered off the backboard as he was about to shoot. Addison goes through.
Oh, Raphael. Good perseverance.
14 points for Addison. Syracuse leads by 2 again, 38-36. Here we go again. David Wingate. We're tied again.
Match him up. Of course, Georgetown has yet to press Syracuse full tilt. Nobody on the ball.
Washington dribbles through the pack. Over Ewing, and that's an altered shot. Here comes Jackson. Georgetown looking to regain the lead. Reggie Williams. He's got it. His first field goal tonight, Bill.
Well, again, he has not played up to his ability of late, but Georgetown normally has somebody else picking up for them. They didn't against St. John's. They need a good half from Reggie Williams.
2 minutes gone of run-and-gun hoops, and it's 40-38 Georgetown over Syracuse. How'd you like to be working 11 o'clock newscast somewhere in the country and having to figure out which 3 or 4 highlights to pick for your 11 o'clock newscast?
Well, Steve Anderson has the same problem here. They could be showing a lot of them.
Derek
Syracuse looking to tie it up again. The Pearl should have taken it. Takes it the second time. Short. Ewing another bound. This is a 4-on-2. Michael Jackson is fouled by Pearl Washington, and that's 3-on-Dwayne.
Again, it's that trick little defense there. Ewing out top, sliding in the back. Able, he comes all the way from the point, down in. Good position. Watch the strength now.
Whoa.
FVL with a piece and right away turning out. Oh, how would you like to be a small forward or a guard with him?
Whatever your question is, the answer is no.
No, yes, you would. He'd be pitching it out to you.
So Reggie Williams hits another field goal, and quickly the Hoyas have a four-point lead, 42-38. We played nearly 3 minutes of the second half. Rick Monroe hit that jumper at the buzzer in the first half, nearly at the buzzer. They stole the inbounds pass and another shot. I don't know where Ewing is on this defense. Good pass into Alexis.
Monroe. Pretty play.
And Wingate at the other end. Nearly a goaltend. Syracuse gets it back.
Cycling with a piece of the ball. And you're right, he may have hit it on the way down after it hit the glass.
So with 3.5 minutes gone, second half, the Orangemen looking to tie it up at 42.
Now, Ronnie Cycli is not being played by Patrick Ewing. If he could become a threat, he could help this club. You saw Ewing able to help out on Washington. If Cycli could just create some offense, it would be helpful to Syracuse.
A 2-3 zone from Syracuse. Bill Martin goes over Cycli, and Cycli grabs the rebound. 4 minutes gone. Syracuse looking for the lead. Next dead ball will be a television timeout. We could use it. And there's the dead ball, a foul call. It's away from the ball, Bill, I think, against Reggie Williams.
Yes.
That's Reggie's third.
Now Michael Brown unable to get into the flow of the game. Good move with Monroe onto the floor. It's been very helpful.
So we thankfully take a breather. We are still tied at 42. We're looking at 32,229 fans doing the wave. That is the third largest dome crowd. It is 153 shy of the largest on-campus crowd in history.
And some of these people have to read about it tomorrow. They can't see the floor. The Pearl attracting Patrick Ewing. He had left Ron Cycli. Wise move, not fouling.
He throws up that dead ball, Bill, without rotation. It's unique.
He's soft touch. I was in Dallas, by the way. Syracuse has nuts or fans all over the world. Gary Myers down there writing for the Dallas paper. They're having a big get together of Syracuse fans to watch this ball game.
Must be more fraternity brothers, huh? All right, we're tied at 42. We were tied at halftime at 34. We've not yet played 5 minutes of the second half at the Carrier Dome in Syracuse. Addison.
Oh. Again, Monroe getting rid of the basketball.
16 points for Addison. Syracuse leads by 2.
Ronnie Cycli come over, challenge the shot, made Perry McDonald throw the ball long for the big rebound. Patrick Ewing, and this you gotta love, great aggressive rebounding down underneath Wendell Alexis. Good rebound position. Is that number 3?
Number 3 on Patrick Ewing. He stays in the lineup. Cycli playing with 3. Syracuse with the ball and a 2-point lead. Addison again. What a show!
Oh. Raff has that stroke down tonight, and he ran all the way cross court to get himself in position to receive the ball. John Thompson.
Timeout, Georgetown. Our score, Syracuse leads by 4, 14:51 remains second half. High-low, what is that all about?
Well, they run a high-low set on the out. Cycli moves up. One of the Lexus will end up filling low and cutting across to the open spot. It's very tough to defend. Raphael Addison and Eddie Butler taught him that stroke Snyder High a few years ago.
You know all the coaches on the recruiting trail.
Well, I got to know him because we ended up friends. We didn't get many other players.
18 points for Addison. The Orangemen had their largest lead since just a couple of minutes into the game when they led 6-2.
Boy, Georgetown fell asleep on the inbounds pass.
All right, let's check it. Ewing is sitting down with three fouls. Cycli is playing with his three. Ralph Dalton in for Georgetown.
Might be a good gamble by Jimmy Boeheim to get Cycli out when Ewing is out.
Absolutely. Well, they had a Matador defense there. And now the foul call against Alexis. And that's two on Wendell.
You know, it's tempting. You're sitting there, your club's playing well, to leave the man in. So it's a big decision for a coach. Should you go for the kill or extend the time on the floor? John Thompson, obviously, with Patrick, choosing to steal some time.
You know, another thing, the Pearl is playing with three fouls now, too, Bill. Perry McDonald's the line, just a 48% foul shooter. It's unbelievable how the kid has trouble shooting foul shots.
Of course, getting back to the Pearl, it's easier for a guard if he doesn't dribble and charge. You know, he can control himself a little bit. When you're inside, all the action's coming at you.
Syracuse looking to go up by six. Remember, St. John's went up by 18 Saturday and nearly got caught. But that was at Landover.
Man to man.
Addison wants it. Addison.
Nice tip. Oh, with the left hand. What a break for Georgetown. They need a basket, Len, badly.
Even if we wanted to talk, folks, you wouldn't hear us.
Now, the game itself carries so much excitement. We're just going along for the ride.
Bill, this is absolutely the most joyous assignment for any sportscaster to do Syracuse and Georgetown in the Carrier Dome.
Well,
Bill
I like
Martin,
that.
That's a big basket from Bill Martin.
And not an easy one. In the slot, about 18 feet, and he set up. Carefree. Nice.
Jackson
hand.
Seals. Here come the Hoyas. Michael Jackson on a pretty move.
Absolutely sensational from the steal at half court all the way to the finish.
And now what was an 8-point lead moments again down to four. 12:40 remain. 3-on-2. Addison.
Alexis with the pass. Raphael, strong move.
Jackson lost it. 20 points for Addison.
Great catchable bounce pass. Aggressive move to the glass. Right over Dalton. Very impressive, but don't forget, Georgetown is like a heavyweight champion who you knock down. He becomes ferocious getting off the deck. Backcourt violation.
Ewing's back in the lineup now. Just remember that little run there was sans Ewing. Ewing is back.
And that good gamble because it paid off. And that's the tough thing about coaching.
That's right. That's right. Give Jim Boeheim the two.
That's
said,
right.
Maybe we'd rest Cycli. Well, you win that one, Jim.
I sure did.
Georgetown ball. They trail six.
Got a Pearl rest for that offense. He's just floating around that foul area. Until now.
Floyd lost it. Here comes the Pearl. A blocking foul against Michael Jackson. And that's Jackson's third. So four Hoyas and two Orangemen with three fouls apiece.
I've seen a lot of players But I've never seen anybody who enjoys the action like Dwayne Pearl Washington. He's in the middle of traffic, came up with the steal. Here, a little out of control. But as soon as the play stops, he looks into the audience just to see if there's anybody there. He missed saying hello to. Just enjoys the throng.
All right, the team foul situation. Good look at the Pearl. John calling for the defense. Four team fouls on Georgetown and two against Syracuse. 11:50 remaining regulation.
Cycles got to help them with some offense.
Man to man.
Ewing matched up.
Good and Jackson steals. That's an easy two.
What a read. Stepped in.
Ooh. Remember how cold Michael Jackson started? He has a dozen now. Look at the Pearl. Looks like he's on the Brooklyn Queens Expressway. Addison. Ewing the rebound. Back come the Hoyas trying to close to within two.
Chris, they've been there before. You saw John Thompson saying, slow down. Run the offense.
15 rebounds for Ewing. Jackson nearly walked. 11 minutes to go. Broadnax. Tipped by Alexis, and he keeps it. And Pearl strolls up memory lane with Syracuse leading Georgetown by four, nearing the halfway mark of the second half. Cycling travels.
But that's what Patrick Ewing does. Made a good cut there, Ronnie Cycling. If you don't have it, dish it out.
David Wingate checking into the lineup. He's replacing Kevin Floyd, getting his defensive assignment. Here's Wingate.
You've got to score! You!
David's been held to two field goals.
The 2-3 slows Patrick Ewing down a little bit, though. They're not able to get him the ball. He's more of a rebounder, an offensive threat off the glass.
They're daring Wingate to take it. Jackson. The high arcer. Rebound, Addison. Syracuse out rebounding Georgetown in the half. 9-3.
Raphael was up there. Upper deck.
Exactly midway second half now. Offensive foul against the Pearl. That's four, Bill.
I believe he was still moving. The Pearl likes that left hand head and shoulder fake. He did it before. Check the feet. Michael's still moving.
Now maybe the official said, gee, we've called two the other way. You got to call one this
tough,
way.
Tough, and that sort of hurts Syracuse, obviously.
Well, the fouls have stopped the Pearl now. He has four. So Ewing rested a while. Syracuse made a run. Now without the Pearl, we'll see if Georgetown makes up the four-point deficit. Inside of 10, it's now. Bill Martin over Cycling.
Tough shot. Now the full extension of the press. On the ball.
The center comes up to help out. It's always a good play, but they have to get it across.
No point guard in the game now.
They get it up from Monroe. Michael Brown has replaced the foul plague for Washington. Here's Brown. Freshman goes over Ewing.
Good looking shot.
Alexis tips. Cycling's got it.
Volleyball right now.
Syracuse by four again as we near the 9-minute mark.
Goodness.
Oh. Count that one for a couple extra.
16 points. Ewing's first points of the second half. Brown took it over Ewing. Ewing grabs a rebound. The Hoyas looking to tie it here. Martin, we're tied again at 54.
Classic fast break, Lynn.
Addison, blocking foul, called against Jackson. And that's four on Michael Jackson.
Great feet. Quick. Well, that's a tough call. Right in the middle of all that action. Raphael.
The individual foul totals are telling the story and will continue the rest of this game. So Jackson joins Pearl with four fouls sitting. Two point guards on these clubs have to rest. That affects how teams move the offense.
Now Broadnax has to handle the ball a lot more. It could be a That's one of those nickel dimers. 5 and 10.
That's two that he's gotten on that. And that's Wingate's third. That may be the Hoyas' seventh. Let's see.
This is a little tick. In the playground, they call you a sissy if you call that one.
All right, that is the sixth team foul. Syracuse only committed three, so each Georgetown foul here on out will be free throws.
I'm sure Jimmy Boeheim's concerned now. Raphael's the point guard. They've got two scoring guards out there, Monroe and Michael Branham. That's going to be it. Nice little cut, but a bad pass.
Good steal. The Hoyas trying to take another lead. Rodnax. No. Ewing fights for it. Stolen away. Addison. Here he goes one on four and backs off.
They are involved. Both clubs totally immersed in this game.
Brown. Hands call the foul. So McDonald picks up a second, and that's the seventh team foul, so now we'll have the parade to the line.
And Horace Brodnax being beckoned over now by John Thompson. He's going to be his extension. Look at the team fouls.
Michael Brown is an excellent foul shooter, terrific shooter all the way around. He's fifth in the conference from the field and shoots 86% from the line. How's it like to be a freshman in front of 32,000 plus, huh?
Maybe that's why he came here, huh?
Syracuse looking for a two-point lead with 8 minutes to go.
First place today, look around to see where they fit. A lot of them. Not so much who's in attendance. Can I get my minutes?
Minutes are tough to come by. Remember, Syracuse only going seven deep tonight. Georgetown, 9 or 10. The fouls continue, though. They go deeper. Ewing misses. Addison blocked out. Grabs a rebound. Hawkins. 7.5 minutes to go, and Syracuse looks to go up by four.
Andre Hawkins, a fine job bodying the big man further out. Not a good shot.
McDonald comes away with it. The Hoyas look to tie with 7:20 remaining. Martin blocked, and a foul called against Alexis, his third.
Billy Martin may have gotten away with a walk out in the wing.
Yeah, maybe.
Got a little extra step to the hole. Alexis coming over to help out. Ooh.
Remember they called one on Mullen?
No
similar.
Token on that one, but he got away with it. And look at Hawkins making sure that Ewing can't get involved.
That was even a close foul. He had the ball pretty good.
That's like Andre Hawkins. I took that bad shot. When you're center, people call him your horse, works hard, plugs away. When he does something bad, you're really not as upset at him as you are somebody being hungry just to light up the scoreboard.
So the Hoyas, who did well from the line in the first half, 0 for 3 in the second half. Make it 0 for 4. Have a feeling points may be tough to come by in the final 7 minutes here. Each point's going to count. 56-54. Inside of 7 minutes now.
Monroe taking over the duties. Handling it pretty good thus far.
The Pearl and Michael Jackson, four fouls apiece resting. The two centers, three fouls apiece. Addison fights. What a game he's having. Alexis. No basket.
No basket.
Offensive foul. Four on Alexis.
Jimmy Boeheim beside himself. Perry McDonald. Oh. Terrific positioning. And you feel for Jimmy Boeheim. Possible three-point play. Alexis with the long one. Raphael, sensational grasp of the ball. Good dish. Down underneath. Set up early.
And a pretty fair call by one of the best officials in the country, Hank Nichols. Syracuse leads by two. For Syracuse, but the most authoritative 2 points of the night, a couple of minutes ago. Remember this one?
Well, they need an extra pound of pressure in the ball after this one is send it in. Thank you. With authority. And if you weren't sure, another shot at it. Great pivot foot movement there without walking. There is left foot.
There is the number one draft choice in the NBA this spring. I can't imagine it be anybody else. The rebound. Syracuse out rebounding Georgetown 15-6 in the second half.
And that team that he goes with will border on the elite in the NBA, regardless of who it is.
Well, Bill Russell with offense. Looking to tie at 56. Ewing doesn't do it. Cycli tipped it away from Martin to Hawkins. Syracuse, as Pearl is back in now with the four fouls. 6:15 remaining. The Orange lead by two. But again, the points not coming fast and furious, Bill.
Well, that's the helter-skelter atmosphere right now in this ballgame. Everybody diving, scrapping.
That was the point guards both out for a while there.
True.
Cycli went through his hands. Ewing does it himself into the fourth court to Broadnax. Backs away, really runs into Ewing inside of 6 minutes.
Doing a little bit of everything.
Ewing has 16 points and 16 rebounds.
Even that fumble by Ron Cycli, you know, it's Ewing, you know. Patrick's there, you got to be careful.
Bill Martin, we're tied at 56. Oh, a 13 points now for Bill.
Not a bad prospect either, by the way, Len.
And Syracuse takes a quick time. What? Jim Boeheim didn't like something he saw.
No, he's talking to Ron Cycli about that fumbled pass, saying, relax.
All right, we're tied. 5:22 remaining.
He's a little excited.
That's right. Look at this. Jackson, Pearl, Alexis with four. Ewing, Williams, Martin, Cycli with three. This game goes into one or two overtimes or three, as that game did a couple of years ago. You're going to see some interesting people in the lineup. But let's get through 5 minutes and 15 seconds first before we start talking about overtime.
The man defense, Georgetown.
Addison, again.
Well, that's old-time basketball. Monroe able to create something. The pinch move defensively, the little dish to Rafael Addison.
22 for Rafael inside of 5 minutes, and the Orangemen lead the Hoyas by two. The Hoyas are number two now. St. John's is number one in America. The AP poll has Syracuse number eight. The ESPN poll has them 10. 4.5 minutes.
2-3 zone has really caused some problems for Georgetown. They've been fighting for shots. Ewing's been out of the game with Hawkins banging him inside. Offensively, not able to be involved because the reach in there.
And if that's on Alexis, I have him fouled out. You notice Cycli's out of the lineup now. They have Hawkins playing center position. So Alexis fouls out of his second game this year and finishes with 7 points. So now we'll see what the Syracuse bench is made of. Will he bring Cycli back with three or not?
I think he will.
Williams replaces Perry McDonald for the Hoyas. 4 minutes and 19 seconds remaining in regulation. Syracuse leads Georgetown by two, 58-56. Jackson, pass inside to Reggie, and a foul.
And this is going to be number
four. Cycli can't believe it. There were two men near the ball, and I thought it might have been the front man, but Cycli just picked up his fourth.
He was too removed. Jimmy Boeheim with a little ballet move on the sideline.
Giving us the replay before we get to see.
Well, he's looking for that move where the man moves
well, look
his
for
back
the front
into
man. I thought it was going to be Hawkins from behind, but all right.
Yeah, interestingly enough, Patrick Ewing with 2 points this half. That's all. And it's that 2-3 defense.
And the Hoyas make a free throw in the second half. 8 points for Williams. And quickly, Perry McDonald comes. Well, he will come back. Apparently, he's going to replace Williams.
Wouldn't be surprised if it's an all-out press. Right now.
Tied at 58. Now the substitution. Williams sits down. Here comes McDonald. 4:16 remaining. We're back where we started an hour and a half ago. Tied. Go, go, go. solid defense. 4 minutes remaining, tied at 58. Addison and Jackson tips it away. Syracuse keeps it with 25 seconds remaining on the 45-second clock.
Can't relax with Michael Jackson. He anticipates reads. You've got to show the ball. Syracuse a few times haphazardly lofted it. He's come up with it.
Situation almost seems tailor-made for some Pearl Washington heroics, doesn't it?
He likes crunch time, no question.
There he is now, 3:45 left, but the 45-second clock is winding down to 10. 9. 8. Monroe, that's the shot that tied it at halftime. Martin lost to Syracuse, gets a fresh 45 with 3:35 remaining.
And a big break. Forcing Syracuse, although Syracuse has been patient, they're not getting the kind of shots of late that they would like.
Addison.
They like that one.
24 points. 60 to 58 Syracuse. 3:25 remaining in regulation.
That's one of the few times you can say Georgetown didn't react quickly in the ball game.
Jackson. Martin. And a foul on Addison.
Major rebound.
Three fouls on him.
Now we talked about Billy Martin having a future in this game at another level. This is a big time rebound in traffic. Oh, gather it in. And unfortunately for him, he really was caught under the rim somewhat. Couldn't get the ball to roll over.
So Martin will look into a sea of waving arms from the Orangemen and their fans as he shoots 69% almost from the line. And missed all three of his foul shots here in the second half.
You can see psychologically, Georgetown, when they missed, they were almost turned away knowing they were going to miss. It's not a confidence builder. Jimmy Boeheim trying to stir the crowd.
Look at those arms.
What a rebound.
You win. A foul. And it's tied. What a foul.
This is going to be on Cycli too, I think.
Or Hawkins. Cycli just fouled out. Fouled out of his fourth game this year.
You know, you can't relax against this club. Look at the quick movement, Cycli. And you've got a little story I think you should tell, too, about the referee signaling Cycli. Look at that step in quickly, reaching way over his shoulder. No question about the foul and the roll and the story on Cycli.
Well, that's right. Earlier this year, the official wiggled two fingers, and Cycli thought it meant two shots, and it wasn't. It meant one and one, and he didn't move on a rebound try against Villanova, much as it happened here. All right, checking in, Derek Brower. What a position for a freshman to come in.
And this has been with a quiet scoring second half. I think he has 4 points this half.
That's right. Looking for his 19th. We're tied at 60. Swish. 61-60 Georgetown on the three-point play. Two Orangemen, Wendell Alexis and Ronnie Cycli, have fouled out. Syracuse going with a freshman in this situation, Derek Brower. 2:50 remaining in counting. Now Georgetown's up by one.
Wingate with the hands, slam.
Four on Wingate. Well, it's four or five on nearly everybody.
Believe it or not, I believe all the fouls have been reasonably good calls. You know, they had to be made one way or the other. But it's the aggressive nature of the basketball game that's causing so many to be called.
Now Addison, he has 24 points. Ewing has 19. Here's Reggie Williams. McDonald goes out. Remember, Georgetown shuttling it out. They're fresh.
A little offense, defense, I think, too. Reggie Williams able to drill it.
Boy, we talked about Addison really struggling at the line this year. Comes in tonight, bangs him home.
Well, that shocked me when we saw that stat.
He's 5 for 5 from the line. Look at that free throw percentage. He was well over 80 last year. 26 points for Raphael Addison. Syracuse leads 62-61. 2:45 remaining. The 45-second clock stays on till the end. I'm glad. Good rule this year.
Sure is.
Play ball.
Everybody has to help out on the rebounding for Syracuse. Lately, Georgetown's been able to attack the glass.
Remember, each team has three timeouts remaining. So a lot of strategy can go on in the final couple of minutes.
Nice play.
Oh! Georgetown keeps it.
Brower got away with one, I think. Billy Martin with a strong move. John agrees with us.
Yeah, tap, tap, foul, says John.
But Brower aggressive. Good reaction baseline. Ooh, a little of that upper body whacked around.
Another 45 seconds for Georgetown. 2:14 left. Syracuse leads Georgetown 62-61. Just another Georgetown-Syracuse night.
Huh? Typical.
Two minutes remaining. Michael Jackson.
Well, this Ewing. Is a push off by Hawkins, I believe, or Brower.
Well, Ewing, I saw push,
yes.
And now they're calling it on either Brower or Hawkins on the push.
I thought Hawkins did it, but they might.
Brower.
They might give it to Brower. Ewing with a great holdoff on the weak side now. He didn't get the pass there. Wingate had an angle. Here's Brower. Little lower arm. Tough to rebound even for Patrick Ewing. With a little forearm in the back.
See something?
I'm a big fan of the visitor nailing that to silence the crowd.
Makes it easier for us.
And I'm always talking about my golfing friends who want complete silence.
That's right.
I say, you gotta be kidding. You ever been to Carrier Dome?
He is really a 7 foot. We set a Russell with offense and a Chamberlain who can shoot free throws. 63-62, Georgetown. Patrick Ewing with 21 points. A minute 45 to go in regulation.
So Patrick really doesn't have to do anything but be a one-man zone in there. I don't think Syracuse will go to Brower very much.
Well, they've got Addison who's been the big gun, but Pearl, where have you been? Hawkins lost it. Georgetown ball, a minute 20 to go. They've got the lead by one.
Staying with the 2-3 that we're looking at the bench. Jimmy Boeheim now switching, looking to go man-to-man.
Now you see the game clock, the 45-second clock's at 25. Georgetown leads by one, 63-62, inside of a minute. 45-second clock is now at 12.
Georgetown, the possessor of a terrific delay game.
45-second clock is down to 5, Bill.
Nice steal by
Brower. And Syracuse, if they want, can hold for one shot the way Boeheim did at St. John's last year, trailing by one. Seconds to go. Syracuse trailed by one. 63-62. A year ago, Bill, you and I were at St. John's. Similar situation. Syracuse trailed by one and held for a last shot and gave it to Greg Monroe, who took it, scored it, and won it. 82-81 in regulation a year ago. Will he hold for one here again, trailing by one?
I've only been out of coaching 5 years, but thinking has changed. A lot of clubs figure, well, they're rated higher. We want a chance to beat them. We're going to go for the winner. I, for one, always like to take a good shot early enough to have my people attack the glass. Ron Cycli's not in the basketball game, so that might be a differing philosophy for Jimmy Boeheim. He's done it before. I don't see any reason why he won't. On the other hand, you might see Georgetown really pressuring him, trying to get him away from what they want, and maybe an overplay on Rafael Addison, who
All right.
probably is the guy to look.
Well,
for the jump shot for.
As our statistician Sandy Montag has told us, Addison with 26 points has kept out of that foul trouble. He has three where others have had four. 34 seconds. You look for Addison, I look for Pearl.
We'll Brower inbounding, not used to it. Very lucky to get it in.
27 seconds remaining. And they're trailing by one. They've got the ball. And another timeout.
I think they were looking for one early. If it didn't show, the Pearl didn't have it. Bring it back out. Let's get some composure. And of course, Jimmy Boeheim wanted a foul called when the Pearl went baseline. Changes your thinking a little bit now.
All right, Washington has 8 points. Well, what does it do for you now? Well, you have 16 seconds.
I think the Pearl will try and penetrate. Now, Jimmy's philosophy, as we know, he'll wait for the last shot, take it. But the Pearl is very good at creating things. That's what I think he did when he went baseline. But I think Boeheim wants him in the middle of the floor. When the pinch occurs, hopefully he can dish to Addison or Monroe, the two good slot shooters. I was surprised Brower took the ball out, believe it or not.
Because he hasn't touched it.
Right, he's not used to it. It's a very tough job. On the sideline, it could have been a turnover. So you might see John Thompson really going for it now, trying to deny the basketball in.
Well, as I've heard you say before, the hardest part of plays like this, the inbounds pass.
Absolutely.
Well, so what's our timeout situation now?
I think it's two, isn't it two, Sandy? Two each? Three for Georgetown, two for Syracuse. 3-0.
Syracuse is out, and Georgetown has three. Okay. So Syracuse has no more timeouts, so they have to inbound the ball. They can't call a timeout if they have trouble inbounding it. So we'll watch that. Again, to set it for you, it's the third largest campus crowd in collegiate basketball history here, 32,229. That's on campus. They've done better in an NCAA at the Kingdome. Superdome, rather, in New Orleans. Mm-hmm. But here we have 16 seconds left in regulation. Georgetown leads Syracuse 63-62. Syracuse is out of timeouts, and should there be a tied-up ball, Georgetown would get it. So those numbers favor Georgetown here. All right, there's the man that...
I'm just curious to see how they play this now.
Brower again will inbound.
All right, John Thompson took a look.
All right.
Yeah, I was just curious to see how they play. They want to see who took it out. He's looking over at us. I can't help you, John.
You know, I had a thought when Boeheim took the cup of water. I said, is that guy taking a Valium? I mean,
there's a lot of people now, John Thompson chatting with Greg Esarek and Mike Riley, who like a big man on the inbounder. So maybe John will come back. I'm sure he doesn't want Ewing out there because he wants him down to block shots and obviously rebound. But that might be what they're changing now. See what set Syracuse had on the floor. Now match up. Deny the basketball as best they can. So you don't want the Pearl to touch it because he's going to run the show.
Right.
So they may even force it into somebody else's hands just to delay their progress.
Again, we should note the fellow who took the shot in similar circumstances a year ago, Greg Monroe, who has not made a field goal in the second half. He is the fellow who tied the game at halftime. And you know, I look at that score, you know what I think about? The orange that hit the backboard when Patrick Ewing missed the foul shot. They gave him two shots. He made both of them. The difference of that one may have been a fan who threw an orange.
He'll be enrolling at another school if the score stands.
With an escort. That happened early in the game if you weren't with us earlier. All right. 16 seconds left. And a fascinating drama unraveling in Syracuse, New York on a Monday night in January.
They've got Patrick Ewing in the free safety position.
Got to get it in. There's Monroe. Into the Pearl's hands behind the back. The Pearl putting on a show.
He's got it!
6 seconds. Timeout. Reverse there, a semi-spin dribble, absolutely extraordinary, particularly knowing the score and the situation. He is, first of all, the mistake Georgetown made was letting him get his hands on the basketball. It would have been better if they had forced Monroe or Addison with the ball. Their best player, Michael Jackson, on a semi-spin. Bring it back, Pearl. Straighten up. The lean in. That soft, dead shot. Whew.
He kicks it into third gear. You just see it happen before your eyes. Pearl Monroe, his namesake, did it too. Goes up the court. All of a sudden, you see it physically kick into gear, and he lays it up without rotation and hits the bottom of the net.
Well, under control. Little Jimmy Brown in him, too, coming up off the floor. Great semi-spin. Plenty of room between the defender. Oh, great set play.
All right, 6 seconds left now, Bill. Pearl hasn't won it yet. If you saw what happened in Boston Garden yesterday with 4 lead changes before Larry Bird won it, you know it's not over yet. Georgetown has 6 seconds.
They may give it a shot to half court with that one timeout.
Well,
one timeout
they
remaining.
Have to come the length of the floor.
And they're upset at John now. Jimmy Boeheim wants them out on the floor. John taking full use now.
Georgetown, after 29 straight wins, is 6 seconds away from 2 straight losses for the first time in a couple of years.
Reggie Williams in the ball game to inbound with Derek Broward down on the ball. John's calling the timeout now.
And that's his last timeout. No timeouts remaining.
He wanted to see, I believe, and he was a little upset. He didn't have enough people down the floor. He only had one man to pass it to. Interesting change. A lot of people like the ball at half court. John wanted the timeout right away. Now he's got to go right for it.
What's he discussing with Hank Nichols?
Well, I wish I knew. He's undoubtedly maybe asking him, can he run the baseline? But I really believe now he's got to go to half court with the pass. Another pass for a quick shot to keep Patrick Ewing low for the tip-in. Jimmy Boeheim, of course, very happy that the Pearl, after disappearing for a couple of games against Providence in Connecticut, comes up with this absolutely extraordinary. Right there, Michael Jackson really dropped off his man, didn't get himself free. The semi-spin, that's a camp move. Turn square, stroke that ball, great follow-through, dead shot, nailing it.
You remember the one he hit against Boston College from half court to win one. That's when the legend of the Pearl grew a year ago as a freshman. Here, he hopes his shot beats Georgetown, but still 6 seconds to go.
Well, you've got to look for getting the ball into half court first. They might throw the ball up in the glass, let Patrick Ewing attack it. Or if they can get it fast enough, end up with that jump shot. Depending on Reggie Williams is taking the ball out, that sort of keeps him out of it. He will not be able to get the shot. So you got Wingate, Martin, and Jackson on the floor. They have to get free in the front court here. It's got to go from Jackson to one of the forwards up to Patrick Ewing.
Here we go.
Turnover.
They throw it away. Syracuse ball. No timeouts left.
And now Syracuse can't relax either because the pressure of Georgetown, any turnover to backcourt might end up with a layup.
No time off the clock.
I think it just touched his hands and it really went out of bounds directly.
Bodies fade. He threw it in the backcourt, and the Pearl gets fouled. Broadnax fouled him. And Pearl is 0 for 3 at the line in the second half, and not a fabulous foul shooter, as we've noted. Wait a second.
Don't forget, Len, how quickly Georgetown gets the ball down the floor.
Right.
They can do things as explosively as any club I've ever seen. So if there's a miss, there's a shot. If he makes one, the other one's a miss, there's still a shot to tie it.
4 seconds to go. Now the substitutions. Brown for Broward. The Pearl tonight hit the thrilling, dramatic shot, but that's just the start of it with 4 seconds to go.
Georgetown doesn't have anybody underneath. They've only got one rebounder.
Well, they have to put two.
They're going to put Michael Jackson down in
there. Yes, they have to. The rule is you must have two opposition players.
If he misses, the Pearls liable to get the second one back to himself. Two, they call it intentional. Clock moved 2 seconds also. Michael Jackson right on top of it.
That's right. They got to put it back to four. Called an intentional foul, so he'll have a second shot. So the Hoyas will have a desperation try to tie the game or win it, whatever he does here. And Syracuse doesn't want a foul.
Now they have to go deep.
They're down by two, looking for the tie. Michael Jackson. No! Syracuse wins! A shot with 6 seconds left, hits a foul shot. Michael Jackson misses at the buzzer. Syracuse hands the Hoyas their second consecutive loss, 65-63. We will take a break. We'll come right back to a delirious Carrier Dome in Syracuse, New York in just a minute. There's the final score. They are still on the court. It is Bedlam. We are down in the middle of it. We'd just like to tell you good night as I'll tell you, it is a wild scene here at courtside as Pearl Washington made the shot, then the foul shot, and Bill, it's a little crazy.
Well, the Pearl did it with a playground move. Unbelievable. And we're going to get killed if we don't get out.